Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents White Pine, The Natural and Human History of a Foundational American Tree, by John Pastor. Narrated by Jonathan Yen. Between every two pine trees, there is a door leading to a new way of life. John Muir. Introduction. My father was a carpenter and a cabinet maker. Like any good cabinet maker, he could distinguish different species of wood just from the smell and texture of sawdust in the shop or on the job site. The most abundant sawdust in his shop, and there was a lot of it, was from white pine. My father carried the resinous scent of white pine sawdust with him. We had white pine furniture in our living room, slept in white pine beds, and placed our clothes in white pine bureaus. After he returned home from World War II, he framed our house with white pine 2x4s and paneled the walls in the living and dining rooms with tongue-and-groove pine planks, which he got cheap at the lumberyard because everyone else had switched to using drywall. In my childhood, these walls were a creamy white with a few sepia knots where the branches had once emerged from the trunks. Over the years, the planks darkened so slowly that I didn't notice the change until I moved away to college and then to grad school and beyond. Each time I went home to visit, I noticed that the panels were slowly and steadily turning a rich burnt sienna, like pumpkin pie. Later, I and my friends and colleagues worked in primeval forests on Black Hawk Island in the Wisconsin River. One stand contained large, old-growth white pines. The huge trunks of these trees, between 2 and 3 feet in diameter, were free of branches for 60 feet or more above the forest floor. Each pine could easily have provided 3 clear 16-foot logs, prime timber for the region's sawmills. But most likely, the loggers who cut the vast pineries of central and northern Wisconsin in the 1800s did not bother with this particular stand because it was too small. In addition, floating the pines down the Wisconsin River through the canyons and falls of the Wisconsin Dells immediately downstream just wasn't worth the effort or the danger of log jams. And so, these pines have remained untouched to this day. Every time we walked into this white pine stand, I felt as if we'd entered a different world. The air was cool and fragrant. The crowns of the pines towered above us and above sugar maples in the understory. During autumn, the maple leaves glowed a scarlet red, made even more vivid by their juxtaposition with the deep green pine needles above them. Over the centuries, the dead pine needles and sugar maple leaves that fell to the forest floor decayed and built a black humus that smelled faintly sweet and resinous, like my father's workshop. The images and smells of these big white pines over a maple understory in autumn remain for me the essence of what forest means. I am happy that the loggers spared this stand and regret that more old-growth stands were not so spared. I continue to enjoy hiking and canoeing through remaining old-growth pine stands in wilderness areas around Lake Superior and elsewhere. At the same time, I admire the courage and skill of the loggers who felled the pines from Maine to Minnesota and transported them via oxen, horses, and rivers to the mills. And I obviously have fond remembrances of the look, feel, and smell of the paneling and furniture my father made from the beautiful white pine lumber milled from trees not unlike those that grow in this stand. Such conflicting thoughts, whether to preserve or harvest, to enjoy the landscape or a product, are not unique to me personally. These conflicting thoughts underpin the challenges of making environmental policies that both conserve the beauty of our landscape, and guide sustainable harvest of natural resources to support ourselves. White pine is a model species to help guide our thinking about these problems. Throughout this book, we'll trace how white pine helped shape American environmental thought from both Native American and colonial perspectives before and during the American Revolution, through the era of clear-cutting, to attempts to illuminate the details of its complex natural history, and finally, to historic and current efforts to preserve and restore it. Even in areas where no white pines are found, how we think about the landscape we live in has been shaped, in part, by our interactions with white pine over the past several centuries. Eastern white pine, Pinus strobus, is a spectacular species, the largest tree in the North Woods, the one that towers over all others. The North Woods is an immense forest encompassing nearly 1 million square miles and stretching from the shores of Newfoundland to the prairies of western Minnesota. It is bordered by the eastern hardwood forest to the south and the boreal forest to the north. The range of white pine nearly completely overlaps with the territory of the North Woods, where it can be found in pure stands or, more commonly, in mixed stands of sugar maple, yellow birch, beech, red oak, or hemlock. White pines over 40 inches in diameter and 150 feet tall were not uncommon in forests from Maine to Minnesota before the logging era. Trees of such sizes can occasionally be found today in protected wilderness areas, although trees 100 feet tall and 2 to 3 feet in diameter are more common. Under optimal conditions and without crown fires, white pine can live to be 300 years old or greater. By virtue of its abundance, large size, and long lifespan, white pine dominates the North Woods and underpins its stability and resilience to fire and storms. Along with hemlock and sugar maple, white pine is what ecologists call a foundation species of the North Woods. Foundation species are widespread plants of large sizes that exert considerable control over the transfers of energy and nutrients throughout the food web. They also structure food webs by providing physical habitat for animals, plants, and fungi, and control the microclimate that, in turn, modifies the metabolic rates of animals and plants that coexist with them. A foundation species comprises many individual plants that interact with the food web around them in different ways at different stages of their life cycles. Outside of the North Woods, Douglas fir, redwood, saguaro cactus, big bluestem, and kelp are examples of foundation species in their own ecosystems. Rare and uncommon species, rather than foundation species, have been the primary focus of conservation biologists. Because foundation species are abundant, we often take them for granted and are not usually concerned about their conservation. A rare species, however, doesn't have the biomass to control and sustain a food web the way a foundation species can, and there are usually only one or two foundation species at the base of most food webs. When they disappear, the food webs they support can rapidly go awry. By the time we recognize that a foundation species is diminishing, it may be too late to do anything about it. Climate change, increased harvesting, the spread of exotic insects and diseases, and many other factors are together threatening numerous foundation species, lending an urgency to their conservation. White pine has also been a foundation of the cultures of the North Woods, both of Native Americans and European settlers, for the past 400 years. The Algonquin peoples recognized connections between white pines and other species that they revered, such as bald eagles, a view not unlike the ecological concept of a foundation species. Similarly, white pine played an outsized role in the development of the American character. As the botanist and author Donald Cole Ross Peedy wrote, "No other tree has played so great a role in the life and history of American people." White pine was used to build the ships and houses, barns and bridges of America from the 1600s through the Civil War and beyond. Before and during the Revolutionary War, white pine was also a symbol of American independence from the King of England. A white pine image adorned many Revolutionary War flags, including the one raised at Bunker Hill. To these utilitarian and patriotic values, Henry David Thoreau added the value of wilderness after he saw what the loss of white pine did to Maine's North Woods. He also began the first scientific study of white pine seedlings and the role white pine plays in the recovery of forests from logging. The loss of mature forests to white pine logging in the 18th and 19th centuries helped spark a significant transition in the nation's view of the relationship between man and nature. The destruction of forests was a crucial theme in George Perkins Marsh's development of the idea of watershed protection. Influenced by both Thoreau and Marsh, the Hudson River School of Painters created huge canvases of both wild and denuded forest landscapes that also became a force for conservation. White pine, or as we shall see, its absence, features prominently in some of these paintings. The ideas of Thoreau, Marsh, and the Hudson River School led directly to the establishment of the Adirondack Forest Preserve, the first and still the largest wilderness preserve east of the Rocky Mountains, and the location of some of the last uncut white pine forests in the Northeast. The establishment of other wilderness preserves, many also the last remaining strongholds of uncut white pine, followed shortly thereafter. By the beginning of the 20th century, Volney Spaulding, professor of botany at the University of Michigan, Bernard Fairnow, head of a federal agency that was the precursor of the Forest Service, and Gifford Pinchot, the first chief forester of the U.S. Forest Service, were establishing the scientific basis of white pine's natural history and management. A few decades later, the planting of millions of white pine seedlings on cutover land by the Civilian Conservation Corps, CCC, helped the North Woods landscape recover from indiscriminate logging. Even more important, the restoration of white pine and other trees helped the young men of the CCC regain a sense of self-worth and helped the nation recover socially from the Great Depression. These shifts in how we viewed and interacted with white pine reflect the contradictions that have made conservation such a lasting challenge. We love our Paul Bunyan heritage and the beauty of white pine lumber, but we get that wood by harvesting large trees, exactly the sort many people want to preserve. Enormous fires after logging of both eastern and western white pine, a close relative, in the late 19th and early 20th centuries, led to Smokey Bear and the Forest Service's no-burn policy. Yet research by a Forest Service ecologist in the 1960s showed that natural white pine forests require a complex fire regime to sustain them. With the demand to protect homes and cabins from wildfires, that complex disturbance regime has to be created by harvesting timber. Today, everyone hopes that the cabin Grandpa built deep in the North Woods beneath the big pines will be in their family for generations to come. But many don't know, or still don't believe, that the warming climate may threaten the survival of the white pines surrounding that cabin. All these threats to and demands of white pines are happening simultaneously, and each amplifies the effect of the others. Today, Government foresters, landowners, sawmill owners, and conservation organizations, such as the Nature Conservancy, are discovering new ways to manage white pine that mimic natural processes more closely. It is hoped that these approaches will sustain not only white pine, but also other species, watersheds, and landscapes that depend on this foundation species of the North Woods. These approaches recognize that a white pine forest is not simply a warehouse of timber, but also a protector of watersheds and habitat for game and non-game animals, that fire and other disturbances can both destroy and sustain these forests, and that white pine forests are a foundation of the cultures of the people who live in them. This is true not only for white pine, but for other foundation species and the ecosystems they are a part of as well. By telling the utilitarian, cultural, and scientific stories of white pine, I will explore how a foundation species defines and inspires our views of nature and how we live within a landscape dominated by it. I hope these stories will show how white pine can be a model for the conservation of other foundation species and the ecosystems and people they support. Chapter 1: The Evolution and Arrival of White Pine. There is a small old-growth stand of eastern white pine not far from my home in Duluth, Minnesota. It is just off Forest Highway 15 in the Superior National Forest, one of the oldest of our national forests. In the Boundary Waters Canoe Area Wilderness north of this stand, the Superior has many thousands more acres of old-growth white pine forests. But this particular stand encapsulates the history and characteristics of numerous remnant virgin pine forests scattered throughout the North Woods from here to Maine. I walk into this stand, and immediately my eyes travel up and up the straight, clear trunks of colossal trees, pillars touching the sky. 80 or more feet above me, thick branches extend outward and flare gracefully upward at their tips. The hissing of the needles in the slight breeze makes a soft blanket of sound floating high overhead. A red squirrel perches on one of the branches and screeches sharp staccato notes. A pileated woodpecker chisels large square holes twice the size of a playing card in a massive dead snag. It is foraging for carpenter ants, quietly carving their galleries beneath the thick, corrugated, slate-gray bark. Down near the ground, the air enveloping me is soft and scented with needles, resin, and decaying humus. If smells can have a color, this forest smells deep, deep green. Light pours through gaps in the canopy and pools on the forest floor where white pine seedlings soak it up. It is May, and bunchberry, twinflower, wintergreen, wild lily of the valley, wood anemone, rose twisted stalk, and pipsissewa bloom profusely. In a stand like this, there are many generations of pines, some living and some dead. Several generations of large trees, many of them centuries old, shade seedlings and saplings that have been growing a few years to decades. Some dead snags, perhaps even older than the oldest live trees, still stand. Massive trunks of down trees lie on the forest floor. As they slowly decay, they support soft gardens of mosses, lichens, and balsam fir seedlings. These ancient logs may have been rotting for centuries more than many of the live trees have been growing. Altogether, these generations of white pines may span 1,000 years or more. During the past 1,000 years, the changing climate of the earth has molded the character of this forest. Each generation of pines was born in a different climate. The trees, now rotting into the forest floor, lived out most of their lives during the Little Ice Age that ended 150 years ago. The giants whose crowns grazed the sky today were seedlings when the Little Ice Age ended in the early 1800s. Then the climate began to warm as the Industrial Revolution, fueled by coal and oil, started spewing carbon dioxide into the atmosphere faster than the world's forests, prairies, and oceans could take it up. Consequently, today's seedlings will mature in a much different climate than that of their parents. During the coming decades, individuals with traits to survive heat and drought stress will transmit the genes for those traits to future generations. Individuals without those traits will die. Just as a changing climate over the past 1,000 years has shaped the development of this white pine stand, so have changes in the Earth's climate since the time of the last dinosaurs shaped the evolution of all pines. This particular stand is just one stage in the long journey of white pine to northern Minnesota, spanning over 100 million years of evolution, shaped by a changing climate and shifting tectonic plates. The best definition of climate I have read is by Kate Marvel, an atmospheric physicist at Columbia University and NASA's Goddard Institute for Space Studies. A mess of air and water moving together and apart on a rotating sphere. Air and water move together and apart because of the uneven distribution of heat on this rotating sphere we call Earth. Water separates from air when it condenses into raindrops or freezes into snow, sleet, or hail. It recombines with air when it evaporates or sublimates into water vapor. Air and water, in turn, move over the continents and oceans, which exchange water and heat with the atmosphere. The distributions and topographies of continents change as the plates that hold them drift across the Earth and crash together to form mountains or separate to form oceans, all the while taking their inhabitants with them. These changes in the continents and oceans, in turn, affect climate. The interlocking dynamics of continents, oceans, and climate constrain all of life and its evolution. Of particular interest for us, the distribution of water and heat across the Earth determines where different plant species can live. The movement of air partly determines the dispersal of pollen and seeds across the land, and therefore the migrations of future generations of plants, including trees, across that land. And the changing distribution and topography of the land determine where species can potentially migrate as the climate warms or cools or becomes wetter or drier. Before we trace the evolutionary journey of pines, especially of white pine, in response to climate change and plate tectonics, we need to review how evolution works. Evolution is the cumulative change in the frequencies of traits in populations. Groups of organisms that live in the same area and can breed with one another and produce viable offspring. The frequencies of traits in a population change down through many generations in response to the environment. It is important to remember that individuals do not evolve, populations evolve. Natural selection, a process first theorized by Charles Darwin in On the Origin of Species, drives the long-term evolution and diversification of populations and ultimately species. A species is at least one population, but more usually a collection of them, some separated from the others by geographic, behavioral, or other barriers, yet still able to interbreed if the barriers were to be removed. The area that these populations occupy is known as the species range. Natural selection relies on three things. First, individuals vary in the traits that allow them to survive and reproduce. Second, each generation inherits those traits from its parents. Third, some individuals possess traits that allow them to survive longer and pass more of their traits down to their offspring, so the frequency of their traits increases in future generations, while the frequencies of traits of other individuals less well adapted to the environment they find themselves in decline. Variability and heritability of traits that result in differential survival and reproduction is natural selection in a nutshell. Individuals of the next generation might mate with other individuals with other traits that also allow them to survive and reproduce better. As a consequence, generation by generation, a population becomes increasingly better adapted to its environment by accumulating traits beneficial to survival and reproduction, so long as the environment doesn't change. If elements of the environment, such as the climate, do change, then other traits may be better for survival and reproduction. The population then evolves in a different direction. An individual's traits are controlled by its genes, units that are passed down from one generation to the next. Mutation of those genes provides the variability that is the raw material for natural selection to work on. A mutation spreads through the population as the traits it controls are selected. New mutations can spread most rapidly in small, isolated populations where they will not be swamped by the more common genes in a larger population. The longer populations are isolated from one another, the more their traits will diverge. Populations are isolated from one another by many mechanisms, but as we shall shortly see, geographic barriers such as mountain ranges, oceans, ice sheets, and other uninhabitable environments have been particularly important to the evolution of pines. If and when isolated populations reunite, their gene pools will mix. One of four things can then happen. One of the populations can cause the other to go extinct because it is a better competitor for resources. Or the populations may no longer be able to interbreed because their traits have become so different that successful mating and reproduction are inhibited. They have effectively become two species. Or else the two populations can hybridize. If the hybrids do not have viable offspring or have fewer offspring than their parents, then their genes will not spread and eventually they will go extinct. In other cases, especially in plants, the hybrids can survive better and produce more descendants than their parents. Those hybrids have become, or are at least on their way to becoming, a new species. Each of these processes has guided the evolution of pines in response to changing climates and continents during the past 150 million years, resulting in more than 120 species worldwide today. Before pines evolved, all land masses were fused into one supercontinent known as Pangaea. About 175 million years ago, Pangaea began to break apart into huge chunks that eventually became the continents we know today. The southern continents, South America, Africa, Australia, and Antarctica, broke away first, leaving North America and Eurasia still connected in a smaller but still enormous continent known as Laurasia. Then, just before the Jurassic period, North America and Eurasia started separating from each other, unzipping slowly from south to north and opening the Atlantic Ocean. Each continent took its resident plant and animal populations with it, isolating them from populations on other continents and allowing new genes and traits to arise by mutations that were then preserved by natural selection. The oldest known pine, Pinus mundi, lived 133 to 140 million years ago in what is now Nova Scotia during the early Cretaceous, a warmer period than ours, and long before Tyrannosaurus rex flourished. North America and Europe were still connected along their northern fringe, allowing the descendants of this first pine species to spread east into Eurasia and west into North America. By this time, the southern continents were far from North America and Eurasia, which is why pines occur throughout the northern hemisphere in North America and Eurasia, but are absent in the southern hemisphere. Soon thereafter, large basins formed as the final connection between North America and Eurasia was just starting to split. The fossil needles and twigs of P. mundi were encased in the sandstones of the Chasswood Formation that were deposited in these basins. The fossil needles of P. mundi are grouped two to a bundle, called a fascicle, which is attached to twigs that have resin ducts. On modern pines, the ducts exude terpenes and other flammable resins. The charred fossil twigs of this particular P. mundi suggest that it died in a crown fire, perhaps fueled partly by such resins. It seems that pines were intimately associated with fires from their beginning. In a later chapter of this book, we look at how fires today are still shaping the ecology and evolution of white pine and other pine species. Approximately 20 million years later, the Pinus genus evolved into two main branches, the yellow or hard pines and the white or soft pines. These two branches of Pinus are actually subgenera, designated as Pinus and Strobus, respectively. The yellow pines include jack pine, P. banksiana, and red pine, P. resinosa, which currently coexist with white pine in the North Woods. In Eurasia, Scots pine, P. sylvestris, another member of the yellow pine branch, is the most abundant pine from the British Isles, through Scandinavia and the Baltic states, and east across all of Siberia. The yellow wood of these pines has a strong turpentine smell from high concentrations of resins. The rather stout and stiff needles of most yellow pines are grouped two or three to a fascicle, encased by a small sheath attached to the twig, similar to those of the ancient P. mundi. The sheath is deciduous, and the tree sheds the fascicles with their needles after 2 to 4 years. In contrast to the yellow pines, the wood of the white or soft pines has a lighter, almost creamy color. Because the wood of white pines contains less resin than that of yellow pines, it has a softer and more pleasant scent. Modern-day eastern white pine, P. strobus, is the defining or type species of this branch, hence the application of the term strobus to both the species name of eastern white pine and the subgenus it typifies. Like most of its relatives, eastern white pine has 5 soft, flexible needles in a fascicle, which falls from the twigs after 2 to 3 years. The rubbing of those soft and flexible needles in the breeze creates the gentle whispers that we hear when walking through white pine stands, a sound distinctly different from that produced by the stiffer red and jack pine needles. The branching of the genus Pinus into the yellow and white pines was one of the two most significant events in the evolution of pines. As we shall see throughout this book, the differing susceptibilities of the yellow and white pine branches to diseases and other environmental factors determined their ecology, and the different properties of their wood dictated how the timber industry used them. During the ensuing 120 million years or so since the split between the branches, both the yellow and white pines spread east and west across North America and Eurasia, while the continents were still barely connected along their northern fringe. Once North America completely separated from Europe, populations and species on each continent evolved into different assemblages of pines. Beginning about 60 million years ago, at the beginning of the Eocene, the yellow and white pines rapidly radiated into many new species. This was the second important event in the evolution of pines. Constance Millar, a conifer biologist with the U.S. Forest Service, proposed that periodic global swings between warm tropical and cooler temperate climates during the Eocene drove this rapid diversification of pines in North America. Millar's theory of the roles of climate fluctuations has since been verified by the discovery of more fossils and by DNA analyses of modern species, and today it remains the most widely accepted theory of pine biogeography and evolution. Millar proposed that, when tropical climates were widespread in the Eocene, North America's pine populations contracted into isolated refugia at higher and cooler elevations in the Rocky Mountains. At the time, the Rockies were in the last phases of rising, as the now almost completely buried Farallon Plate slid eastward under the westward-moving North American Plate. The complex terrain of different mountain ranges and valleys isolated the populations from one another and prevented cross-pollination. Genes mutated in each population. Some of these mutations made the individuals possessing them better adapted to the local environment. Over time, these mutations spread throughout each population. Later, during relatively cooler, temperate climates, the populations expanded out of their mountain refugia onto the plains to the east. Many previously isolated populations could no longer interbreed successfully and had therefore become separate species, while others interbred and formed new hybrids. Some of the hybrids were less able to compete with their parent species and went extinct, but others outcompeted their parent species and drove their parents to extinction or into marginal habitats. Still later, when the climate entered another warm tropical period, the populations retreated again into mountain refugia. This time, though, the hybrids brought new genes acquired by interbreeding with other populations. Another round of mutation and natural selection in isolated populations followed. Back and forth, each expansion and contraction of the populations in response to climate change shuffled their gene pools, selecting for some genes and the traits they control, and discarding others across the diversity of microclimates, soils, and habitats in the mountainous terrain. This repeated sifting, winnowing, and recombining of genes of the ancestors of the modern pines made the Rocky Mountains one of the world's centers of pine evolution and diversification. Today, there are 40 species of pines in North America. Almost all came from ancestors that spread across the continent after emerging from their Rocky Mountain refugia. 7 million or so years ago, the climate began a long period of cooling, leading eventually to the formation, expansions, and retreats of the great Pleistocene continental ice sheets. The ice sheets extended from the Arctic southward to the mid-Atlantic and midwestern states. The cold episodes of glacial advances during the Pleistocene forced pines once again into refugia, only this time the refugia were in more southerly temperate climates rather than in cooler high elevation climates in the Rockies. The expansions, contractions, and fragmentations and reunification of the pine populations were now in a more north-south direction as the ice sheets waxed and waned rather than in an east-west direction into and out of the Rockies as in earlier times. Out of these new scramblings of the pine gene pool, the modern eastern white pine, Pinus strobus, finally emerged. The last great Pleistocene ice sheet, known as the Laurentide Ice Sheet, stretched from Long Island through Pennsylvania and south of the Great Lakes, and finally into Wisconsin, Minnesota, Manitoba.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.